Revolution Radio proudly presents live from Phoenix, Arizona, the Truth Deny Talk Radio with host Roxy Lopez. Join us here for topics you won't hear about on mainstream news, such as chemtrails, GMOs, nutrition, and conspiracy facts regarding your personal sovereignty. Humanity is 7 billion strong. We are the majority. And now, live from the Valley of the Sun, your host, Roxy Lopez.
And good afternoon, everybody, or good evening for some of you, for some of you in the East. You're listening to Truth Deny Talk Radio, and today is April 26th. It's Friday, and I know you're all looking forward to the weekend, as well as our guest that will be coming on shortly under the show. Again, I want to thank all of you, all the listeners. You know, we're just growing by leaps and bounds, and we really appreciate you. I loved all the emails off of Tuesday's show, so thanks so much. You really enjoyed our guest, George McClure, and he is. He's fantastic, and he's across the board just one of the most humble people I've ever met, actually. And of course, we're going to have at your request, at our guest's request next week, we're going to have from the UFO East Eddie Ranch, James Gilliland, back for the entire 2 hours. When he was on about a month ago, an hour wasn't long enough. He requested to come back. You all were kind of left hanging, so he'll be back Tuesday. And you'll get the full 2 hours. We'll go over a little bit of what we went over last week, last time he was on the show as well. And, of course, we've got quite a month of May. I'm not gonna get into it. If you want to take a look at some of what we have in May, we don't have the May schedule calendar all the way up yet. Just go ahead and go to thetruthdenied.com and hit the schedule page, and you can even take a look at my guests for this evening, who is Patty Greer. You can take a look at all of her information as well. And then, of course, we do provide the video archive of this show, and you all know where to find it on our YouTube channel, The Truth Denied. And, of course, you can find it on thetruthdenied.com. Our guests are always permanently linked up to our website. So anytime you're looking for a guest and you want to get in touch with the guest, no worries. It is always linked up at thetruthdenied.com. So without any further ado, you know, I'm very excited. I'm very excited that Patty and I had gotten in contact with one another. Very excited to hear more of her story. And, of course, I'll give you a little bit of background. A lot of you have been asking some questions already, and we'll get to those questions. But in the summer of 2007, Patty Greer had a life-changing out-of-body experience in the center of an English crop circle. It was midday in June, and she was all alone, so she nestled into the wheat and passed out. When she woke up, she saw things in the sky that she had never seen before. She wasn't alone. Her face was red and her skin felt tight. She began focusing intently on the sky and saw energized entities moving and darting around above her. There were lots of them, and they were everywhere. They looked opaque in color like jellyfish, but were clearly definable and visible to the naked eye. Some even had egg sacs attached to them. How crazy is that? A parallel universe, perhaps. Patty Greer has seen them ever since, everywhere she goes. How about that? And has guided other people to see them with great success. Appearing as some sort of plasma energy, Greer has seen them in America, Australia, and England, with witnesses also spotting them. So Patty has a wonderful story to tell. She also produced a 4 full feature UFO and crop circle documentary, so 4 of them, in her own 2 years, and the 5th movie the following year, with no training or previous experience in the filmmaking whatsoever. Kudos. Amazing. The movies offer hundreds of authentic images of crop circles, UFOs, orbs, and balls of light up close and personal. We're going to talk about those movies as well and give you some more insight as to her experiences from that very first crop circle till the present. Patty has also been given many awards, and I just have to say this is not easy to do, people, especially because her career is not in the film industry. Awards include the 2009 Best Feature Film, UFO or Related EBE, award at the International UFO Congress Convention. She got the 2009 Silver Sierra Award at the Yosemite Film Festival, 2010 Best Feature Film, UFO or Related EBE Award at the International UFO Congress Convention, 2010 Best Musical Score, 2010 Moondance Audience Favorite Documentary Film Award, 2010 Moondance Gaia Award. The list goes on and on. So we are honored, we are privileged to have our guest this evening, Patty Greer. Welcome to the show, Patty, and thanks so much for joining us.
Well, thank you for doing this for so many people around the world, Roxy.
It's easy. And my goodness, your story is just fascinating. I love your energy, by the way. It was so interesting meeting you through the emails and going back and forth. You just have such an upbeat energy. And it's no doubt that these, whether they be ET or whatever these plasma energy fields are, it's no doubt they want to connect with you. I can see why.
Oh, well, thank you. And, you know, I think they want to connect with all of us. It's just up to us to take the time, look up and get quiet.
Well, now, when you, before you even engaged with this crop circle, prior to that, Patty, were you always somebody who was open-minded to, let's say, ETs and crop circles and things like that, and basically, you know, sort of a universal type humanitarian, let's say, or anything like that? Or, because you do say that it changed your life forever, so that's why I'm asking.
I never thought of them as UFOs. I never thought of them as ETs or aliens. That never crossed my mind. And I overlook crop circles altogether like most people. I see it in the news and I think, wow, cool. And then you'd read to the end and they debunk it to death and you'd go, oh, it's those two old guys. And then you go back to sleep. So it was never something that I had focused on or studied. It all came to me in the most peculiar way. And you know, I think I'm finally at the age where we don't want to talk about how old we are anymore, but we do have an awful lot of experience in our basket that we're skipping around with like Goldilocks. You know, I mean, we have so much opportunity when we are full-on adults to be able to choose our path. And going to the crop circles, now that I look at it, seems quite insane, some of the things that I did and the experiences that I had making those five documentaries. I don't know if I do have that stuff today, Roxy, but I'm sure glad I did it, because there's nothing like having an experience where you just all of a sudden are different and it's a jolt you really are going to benefit from.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like it was something positive. It sounds like it launched something. It woke something up, whatever it is. It sounds like it's, you know, your passion just blew up inside of you.
I was dealing with a health issue, which ended up being mercury poisoning from fillings. And, but I was being misled for 7 years. I got the wrong blood test. So I, you know, listened to my doctors and trusted them. I finally got the right blood test, got it out of me. And when I detoxed, it was like, whoa. But while I was completely, I would call it now drunk on mercury, was when I was doing all those things in the crop circles. So I'm looking at it kind of as some kind of an odd blessing, and how accessible I was to the ETs, in my opinion, I think had maybe something to do with being heavy metal in my body, because I had a ridiculous amount of mercury and I'm walking around like a transformer for them, I'm guessing, you know, I mean,
that's interesting.
Yeah. I feel like I finally evolved, you know, there's nothing in me that can be mad anymore that I got poisoned, but you know, now I'm going, wow. I mean, I got to tell you, there was a night, I think the peak of it for me was the Avery Manor crop circle in 2008. It was this fantastic image, which is on the cover of my movie, Crop Circle Update, The Wake Up Call. But it was this big, green, fresh wheat field. And right near the Avebury Stone Circle, which is the center of this phenomenon in southern England. And the formation was this beautiful group of orbiting rings, and all the planets were laid out. But it seemed that I think Pluto was missing, and I should be absolutely accurate, but it wasn't the way that I look at crop circles, but they were missing a planet, and I'm quite certain it was Pluto. So all these people were going wild over this formation that had this big implications about 2012. And I was there that morning in it, and it was really buzzy. And when I flew over it that afternoon, I got fantastic moving footage of it, which I ended up giving to lots of people, because the next morning the farmer decided he didn't want all of us on his land. So he took his tractor and he plowed these huge white lines through the center of the formation, destroying it, he thought. So now we're flying over getting these pictures of farmer damage.
Right.
Intentional farmer damage. And you're just going, wow, that must have been a pretty important message for the farmer to feel a need to do that. And you know what happened? The circle makers came back a few days later and went splat, and all over like more acres of his land were all these different little crop circles, and each one had a message. And when I saw the photo of it at first, I thought, oh, those are sloppy, that was humans doing it. But then when I got in it, each one was so incredible that I took ridiculous amount, hundreds of photos of the interior, because every kind of, if you could call it brushing your hair, different braiding, different parting, different, that's what the wheat looked like, was parted hair. And it was done like with Z's. And I mean, God, it was amazing. And so the circle makers, that's pretty much how they reacted to the farmer being a not so gracious human. They just went, yeah, we'll take this, splat. And I mean, the messages were everywhere, and it really got read pretty broadly, the Avebury Manor crop circle. But the interesting thing was, before I knew how important it was, I was so drawn to this circle, and I can say it out loud now, drunk on mercury, because I know, but I actually went in the crop circle at night at sunset. That's just wrong. And I did it in a skirt and a tank top and sandals. I mean, seriously. And I wasn't like drunk, literally. It didn't look like it at all. I was just a fearless woman, completely fearless. It was kind of silly when I look back. But I went into this crop circle at sunset because I thought it would be very cool to film it at night. So I'm in the middle and I'm walking in the back way. And all of a sudden I got a tickle on my leg and I looked down and I was covered with big spiders.
Oh my gosh.
Covered. And I had on a skirt and a tank top. Next thing I knew, I just had on, you know, underwear.
Right.
Shaking these things off. And I wasn't in a panic like I should have been.
Right.
And so, you know, now that I look back, I'm like, wow, that was weird. And a lot of those moments happened in the crop circles where, who knows, maybe they were the little ETs.
Right.
But they were everywhere, Roxy.
That's crazy stuff.
I would not do that again. But, you know, I think the more regular thing that I did, which I kind of look back now and go, really? Was to get in those little microlight planes. And the pilot would say, door on or door off? And I'm like, you're kidding, right? You mean on my side? Well, the professionals, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, please don't do this to me. Door off, of course. And I go in these little planes, wind and rain, and there's no door on my side. And I'm like, where's the halter? He said, oh, it's just that little belt. I mean, it's like a man's belt.
Oh.
And I look back now and I go, how many times did I fly? Are you kidding me?
Wow. And it seems like because of the mercury poison, I mean, you're making a good point. You were sort of in a fog.
Yes.
You know, but you may not have endured what you endured. So it's all good.
Here I am, the survivor on the other side of that dark tunnel going, wow, that was something. But, you know, I wouldn't give anything back. To go in the crop circles was one of the greatest gifts of my life. And for your listeners, I mean, the most amazing things, in my opinion, about the crop circles, one is walking into it. I can feel you're walking into a tram line, which is where the tractor drives, the farmer drives his tractor in. So there's two tire tracks going in. And, you know, by midsummer, when the crop circles are really active, there's the wheat is like up to your hips. Of course, I'm 5'3", so it gets up to my hips maybe easier than other people. But the wheat's high, and so you can just walk through these tram lines. And the etiquette of walking on a farmer's land is to stay in the tram line so you don't hurt his wheat. And a lot of people probably wonder, you know, does the farmer lose a lot of crop value with a crop circle being put on his land? As long as it's not a wet summer where it gets moldy, they will still harvest the wheat. And it doesn't die. It actually has a higher nutritional content, and it grows healthier. They've tested it. They've done scientific tests on all the different aspects of wheat once it's been changed by a crop circle formation. And definitely those two aspects are really impressive.
Absolutely. That sounds awesome. You know, that brings up something. What do the farmers think? And that would lead me into as well, how long have these crop circles been around? So in other words, someone who's a third or fourth generation, farmer, is this fairly new to them, crop circles? And how do they feel? Are they angry that this is being done? Do they think it's humans? Do they think it's ETs? What do they think?
I think because of the tour groups, the farmers have less grace with it than before. You know, I think that the more people that come onto their property that might be disrespectful or smoking a cigarette or with dogs running around in their wheat, it gets tiring for them. I only had a bad interaction with one farmer, and it was fascinating. It was the very first crop circle I ever went in 2006. And I had my daughter with me, and it was rainy and cold, and we were brand new. We had no idea what we were doing. We were just super excited. And we met these witches in Glastonbury at a store called Witchcraft. And they said, oh, we're going to a crop circle tomorrow. I mean, how could we resist? So we follow their car, and they've got a small car with two Great Danes in the back and a small harp stuffed in the back window. Only in England. So we're following these two ladies, and we get to this place, and the one lady wants to stay at the car with the dogs, but the other lady walks into the crop circle with my daughter and I, guessing where it was with the directions they had. And when we met the lady, well, it turns out she was the Archdruidess of Stonehenge. Wonderful woman, Victoria. And so the three of us head into the crop circle, and the wheat is just wet up to our hips. So it's kind of getting cold as you walk further in. Your jeans are getting wetter and wetter. But, you know, all of a sudden, bang, you're in that umbrella of whatever it is that is that it feels like an elevated electromagnetic field, and everything in your body lights up. Hair on your arm stands up, goosebumps head to toe. Chills on the top of my head. These are the things I feel. And most of the people with me usually feel these things too. It's so exciting when you step into the envelope, which can be 10, 20 feet before you even hit the formation. So it's that kind of the welcome mat of woof. I mean, you can really feel it. And then when you get to the opening of the crop circle, it is breathtaking because you can see huge circles. They can be 60, 80, 150 feet across of just perfectly swirled down wheat with a centerpiece in the middle that looks like a bouquet.
That's got to be a sight to see up close and personal. I'll tell you, that's just got to be magnificent. And then like you're describing, you know, the feeling, the aura, the energy, the difference of the field of energy, literally. And everything, you know, your hair standing up on your entire body.
Yeah.
You know, we've all had that feeling before, but this has just got to be, you know, it's maximum coolness, you know, because you've got the vision, you've got the feeling, you've got the witnesses with you, as well as what you're viewing, which is not normal. It's extraordinary.
It's very, very cool. And when we test it, like, you know, I turned around and my daughter looked at me and she goes, okay, Mom, I'll admit it. I feel it too. You know, like begrudgingly, because she's like a late teenager going, you know, I really want to be cool, Mom, this is weird, you know, but I'll do it with you, humor you. And, you know, all of a sudden she gives me those big eyes like, whoa, I feel this. So we get in the formation and it is just like flawless walls, just not a hair out of place. And, you know, everything was just really, it was amazing. It was, I had no idea what to expect, but all three of us were just, whoo, and it was perfect. I mean, just beautiful. So, we get to the second side of the crop circle and all of a sudden there's this area that's like hacked up, like something attacked it with a hacksaw. And it looked like it just went and went, and otherwise everything was flawless, but this one area, and it was very curious. So we kind of separated and it's raining. And my daughter said, Mom, I kind of want to head to the car. I'm getting cold. I knew the other lady was there. So she starts walking out the tram line and I turn around and both this lady and I, we're running our pendulums. We came together and I said, I think it's a real crop circle. I think somebody did it. And she said, I got the same thing. So we head out of the crop circle slowly. And I hear this man yelling at my daughter and we go running out of the field. And I just panting when I get there, thank God I was late because my daughter was far quicker than I. And the farmer's yelling, didn't you see the no trespassing sign? And over his shoulder is a white strap and hanging in that big farmer bag was a hacksaw. And my daughter said, she just stared at him and he said, I could shoot you for coming on my property. And my daughter said, lo siento, señor, no entiendo nada.
Oh, like, my gosh.
Oh, my God, that was brilliant. So I started speaking Spanish. And then Victoria, who I hardly knew, spoke Spanish. So the farmer begrudgingly goes walking away. We all looked at each other and went, well, that's what happened to that crop circle right there. And that's, in my opinion, the unspoken answer to how do the farmers feel?
Right. Right. Well, I would imagine so. You know, you are trampling, you are on their land. They have a completely different purpose for their land. And now you've got complete strangers coming through and maybe even disrespecting the land. So there's a multitude of reasons. I don't know. You know, personally, I think after a while, it would feel like you live in the National Enquirer land or something, right? So yeah, that's unfortunate. I'd imagine if you're really respectful. Now, do the crop circles return, especially in England, I've heard this before, do they return over and over to the same farms?
Very often, and we'll talk about those three reasons after your break.
Absolutely. Well, we're coming up on a break any minute and we'll just go with the flow until we hear the music. We're a little off on the timers here. I don't know what's going on. But yeah, I definitely want to get inside of that. And for those of you who are in the chat room right now, the producer did put some information for you. But again, you know, we are speaking with Patty Greer. And if you want to go to her website, it's pattygreer.com. So you can take a look at some of the pictures and the orbs and the wonderful photos that she did send to me as well, that will be in the video, of course, of the show. Just fabulous stuff. I would have to say that one of the things when I look at pictures of orbs or any sort of stuff, like even crop circles. And for those of you who are just joining us, we were speaking with Patty Greer. And keep in mind, within a span of 2 years, she created 4 documentaries about UFOs and crop circles. It's just fabulous. We were just about to get into the return of the crop circles. Do they return to the same location every year to make new ones?
Yes, in many cases, they do show up. And one of the areas documented to be the most visited area in the world, but again, it's only cases documented. Think how many there must be that nobody sees. But this area is called Wiltshire, England. It's in the south, middle south area of southern England. And to the east is Stonehenge, the huge stone circle, and sitting in the center is the Avebury stone circle, which is the largest stone circle in all of Europe. And then off to the west is Glastonbury, this medieval town where it's just very druid. And in these areas, it's just sprinkled with sacred sites. And they map out the sacred sites on a map of this area, and they draw what's called ley lines, a direct line between each sacred site. So, you know, each one has a spider web that comes out from it, and where they cross is called a node, a crossing of two ley lines between then four sacred sites. And at the end of every summer, they grab the ley line map at the Silent Circle, which is our research center, and we stick it up on the wall all summer long. They put push pins at the locations where the crop circles appear. And at the end of summer, over 90% of them are sitting on a node, a cross section of two ley lines right there on the node. So there's a very high vibrating field in these areas where there's this enhanced energy of the sacred sites. The other thing that's over 90 percentile is most crop circles are sitting over an aquifer, an underground.
Is that right?
Yeah. Which says to me that it's not just about humans seeing the images and sharing the information and taking in on a subconscious level, maybe, but also going into the water system of the planet and shifting the vibration, possibly, of the water on the earth, in the earth.
Right. Oh, I've never heard that they were over, a lot of them are over aquifers. I haven't heard that one yet.
96% last time I checked, which was a few years ago. That's
high. Oh my goodness. That's incredible. And like you said, there are also people out there that probably have never reported them, kept them to themselves or such. So there's still, there probably are a lot of people out there who don't talk about it for numerous reasons.
Right. Well, you know, I never focus on America, which I probably should. I do live here, but I was introduced to the ones in England and was so blown away that I just went there every year after year after year and couldn't wait for the season. But 2 weeks ago, I spoke for a group, a local group, and they asked me in advance a question about American crop circles. And I thought we hardly hear about them, but the one that did happen this year in Wilbur, Washington, I got personally excited because it was beautiful, really awesome formation, Wilbur, Washington. And I contacted the farmers and they said to me, yes, it's near a sacred site. And we have had a crop circle in our field or a neighbor's every other year.
Wow.
Yeah. So, but the press did a bad job. And then when I read that the farmer was going to mow down the field and a different press came, I called them also. And I said, I make movies. Can I send you one? Please do a good article. You know, be positive. This is an honor. You guys are so lucky. You have this thing here. You know, it's huge. And they were like, they just made a farce of it because they're paid to do so.
And, you know, that's what I was going to ask. And I want to get back to the state of Washington as well. Because I agree with you. I lived in the state of Washington for 14 years, and I definitely have something to convey to you. But I was going to ask you, how does the English government and press, how do they treat crop circles?
Well, the reason I didn't come back in 2009 was because I had too much fun in 2008. But I was out there one day in this beautiful formation filming a woman talking about 2012, a lady that speaks around Europe quite a lot. And we set up the camera and I had this guy that plays music on in the crop circles, and we met, and he's on one of my movies. I used his music. And so these three of us have done the crop circles together, and I've set up the camera. And I start to interview her, but we had to stop because one of the helicopters flew over, you know, take postcard pictures and calendars. So, you know, we kind of chilled there because we fly over too, and it flew away. So I said, we're ready to go now. So we got the thing going, the camera, the lighting is perfect. We're rolling. Here comes the second helicopter. And it circled us low enough to blow our hair for no less than 20 minutes without fail. Now, she and I were the only people there other than Nick that was kind of crawling around digging to see if the wheat was bent or broken. But she and I were sitting there having a conversation saying, just stay calm. You ask how the government treats crop circles and its researchers. it was really hard to decide what to do after 10 minutes, but after 15, I was really starting to get edgy. And she said, they just want to irritate you. And I'm like, yeah, well, what are those two things hanging off the side bolted with a red light blinking? I still don't know if it's a camera or a gun pointed on us, but they just circled us like we were whatever. I didn't appreciate it. And of course, then I did my high, I'm 18 year old and stupid backbend to flip the birds. And they got the money shot. I mean, I'm just guessing. Good one, Patty. That was really stupid. But, you know, 20 minutes, I'm like, come on, seriously, you're tangling my hair. Get out of here. So it finally hit me to be as smart as my daughter, and I turned my camera on them. Oh, what a blessing. And I thought, well, this is great. I'll get them up close and personal. So I got three full circles of them circling right over our heads, and then they flew away. It was like, why didn't I think of that? And we were laughing, and I said, well, that'll be some tight footage. And I backed it up, and it was zero. It was missing footage.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
So they don't like to talk about it either, I guess.
Everywhere I went, I saw them over my car, and then I just decided not to come back in 2009.
To that. Mm-hmm.
Mm-mm. So I didn't like it. I mean, I'm there to do good work, and that made me uncomfortable, and I didn't like it. But, you know, that's not why I'm there, is to do that. But you asked, so I thought that was a good example. A lot of people want to talk about or hear about the human circle makers.
Right.
So I'll tell you about the guys I met one night. Well, I didn't meet them, but I listened to them well enough. And I think this, again, is a great not answer to my opinion of people making crop circles and what I feel are the balls of light making them that I have filmed and photographed. And so many other people have. It's just there's a missing cog between us having the real footage and people getting to see it.
Right.
Yeah.
It's kind That's of unfortunate. That's interesting. Well, you know, I just want to bring up as well another aspect of what you do, which is absolutely courageous. For the most part, those who are interested in crop circles and UFOs and ETs are really of a different sort of nature than those who just, you know, think it's just all a bunch of hogwash. But, you know, you mentioned the Washington State, and there's an NBC report, just to give an idea of even the apparently even the people who owned the land, the fields. And that says a set of crop circles appeared in eastern Washington wheat field last week, much to the amusement of the field's owners. Quote unquote, you can't do anything other than laugh about it, Cindy Geib said, who owns the field along with her husband, Greg. They told the Associated Press, you just kind of roll with the theory it's aliens and you're special because aliens chose your spot. But then they go on in the story to describe it looks like, you know, a crop circle. It looks like Mickey Mouse ears. You know, the whole thing is played down in jest is what I'm saying. That it's kind of funny and it, you know, it covered an acre. Were you able to speak to these owners?
I did. And, you know, I think...
And I'm not trying to be mean about it. I'm just saying, you know, in other words, what I'm trying to depict here is, where did you have a different interaction with them than the Associated Press and NBC News?
Yes. And she's on my Facebook and I see her posting all these organic raw food smoothies and things almost every day. So she's really a farmer and a conscious eater and a conscious person and probably doesn't allow Monsanto on her property. And but the news spun them to make the thing serve the news.
I'm glad that we brought it up because I think for listeners, always pay attention to this. Look at now you've got Patty as a witness, you know, you, Patty, as a witness to this story. The Associated Press, NBC, ABC, all their affiliates spun this story to make it look like the farmers thought it was just one big conspiracy joke kind of thing and ooh, alien beings and blah, when the farmers are actually very conscious individuals and didn't think that at all.
No, it wasn't really interesting.
How unfortunate.
Yeah, well, this is why the wrong people, you know, and look who's buying the Chicago Tribune now. I mean, Rupert Murdoch, I thought he was supposed to go to jail.
Oh, he's too much fun, though. He can't go to jail.
but you know,
yeah, that just kills me.
Paid for, then we're going to get told all the most ridiculous things. But if you're still drinking, I guess I can't say names, but you know, if you're still drinking high fructose corn syrup in a can with a red label, then you're not thinking anyway. And I used to do it, but I just honor my body in a different way. You know, when it comes down to truth and not truth, my favorite guy, Stanton Friedman, he laid out the four rules for debunker. You know, the nuclear scientist, you know, you've probably interviewed him, Stanton Friedman.
Yes.
Yeah. His four rules for debunkers. This is how they're getting away with it. Number one, what the public doesn't know, I'm not going to tell them. Number two, don't bother me with the facts. My mind's made up. Number three, if you can't attack the data, attack the people. It's a whole lot easier. And number four, do your research by proclamation. Investigation is too much trouble and nobody will notice the difference anyway.
Isn't that? Oh, I love it.
He's so great. But this is how that we are sitting as one of the last countries not having our UFO files exposed to the people. It, the dominoes are falling. Everybody's talking about it. And did you see the new Stephen Greer movie, Sirius?
Yes. Yeah, we're an affiliate. Yeah, absolutely. By the way, bringing that up, many people have asked me, so I'm going to ask on the air. They wanted to know if you are any relationship to Dr. Stephen Greer.
No, we're not. We're friends.
Oh, we had bets on that. No, I'm kidding.
No, we asked. Everybody always asks, and I'm proud to carry his name, and I think that he's done amazing work. And I did donate my Oliver's Castle footage to his film, and my name is up there in lights in his movie. I'm just honored to be a part of it and to share his name. But I did meet him in a crop circle once in 2010.
How fun.
Oh, it was great. And what was interesting, and I have photos which I posted, is that we're standing in the middle of the crop circle, and he says, look at this. And he's got in one hand a compass, and he's got in the other hand a compass. And one is pointing north straight ahead, and the other one is pointing north toward his belly.
Hmm.
So in the center of the crop circle, two compasses were pointing opposite directions. And then when we walked out of the crop circle, they both agreed. Then we go back into the crop circle. They went opposite directions.
What is that all about?
Do, 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 do.
I know. That's trippy.
Yeah. So what I love about Stephen Greer and his movie is that he's really bringing forth so much right information. And he's saying things like, we don't need to take down the Pentagon. We need to leave it behind. We don't need to wait for the government to disclose. It's up to us now. One person at a time. And then his punchline was, how do you know when politicians are lying? When their lips are moving.
Right.
So, but he brought up something that I think is really important, which is that it's no longer about the lights in the sky or seeing the ships or all that. It's about the reason that it's being kept secret. It's about how they got here with free energy. And we know this. This is old news to you and your listeners. But this is so huge of a story that they're hiding it because the petrol people don't want to lose all this control and money. But meanwhile, it's true. It's all true. And meanwhile, for hundreds of years, these ETs have been leaving us physical manifestation messages in the fields. And hundreds of years ago, the elders used to say, oh, yes, the fairy rings. Oh, we've seen them for years. I've heard that a lot of times. So we have everything we need to prove it's real. But then we've got the press going, oh, it's lollipops and roses, or it was lanterns or a hot air balloon. I mean, and then everybody goes back to sleep. Come on, really? We have the internet now. That's not going to fly anymore.
Oh, yeah, with the age of instant communication and photos and iPhones, and I mean, you don't even have to have a really good camera anymore to get photos of half of what's going on in the world and the skies. So you're absolutely right, and the information stream is getting huge. You know, I always did say, Patty, that disclosure of any kind is going to come from the people.
It is. We are in it. And we have been. So I I think the nice thing about getting older is not what happens to your skin, but what happens to your brain. You know, all of a sudden kind of tie together your pieces. And this has been my year where I'm having all these, that's why. You getting some of those?
I live in that world. You know I do. You know I do. You know, it's aha after aha, and it you do get to a place where almost nothing surprises you, and it's so much fun when something does surprise me, and I'm sure you know exactly what I mean. The world is not the place. You know this. I know this. You've evolved into this and out of this. The world is not the place I thought it was, and as a matter of fact, the world is more phenomenal than I ever thought it was. And humans are more phenomenal. And the space is more, everything is more phenomenal than I ever imagined. So it's not, you know, and then we've got this real cap on everything, you know, a lid on the truth. And one thing I love that you said, it's over. Because once you identify and you sort of open that door and you discover or remember who you are, where you came from, and what's really happening, you can't go back. You can't go back.
Right. No getting off that train.
No. And it's kind of cool. I think it's very important that as far as the global humanity goes. I think that all the work that you do and I do and many, many, many thousands and thousands of others do, you know, we encourage it, is we're talking to one another, whether it be through a cell phone or a text message or an email or whatever it is, social media networks. We're talking to each other now and we're connecting with each other globally. And I think that that has become, on the one hand, it could be the Achilles heel. On the other hand, it could actually push us forward into this newer light, if you will, newer understanding, remembering, realization of who we are and what exactly what we're capable of being, which I'd like to ask you, what do you think the message of the crop circles are? What is the message that they're trying to get across to humans? Or are they even trying to put a message across? Are they just having fun in fields?
No, I think that there's been many specific messages. And I don't ever have the feeling that they're here to harm us because they've got the technology. If they wanted to harm us, this would have happened long ago. These messages have so many different dimensions, Roxy. There are sacred geometry messages where it's just like a flower or a kaleidoscope where it's just lovely to your brain. And the thing about sacred geometry is it's so symmetric and relaxing for the mind that it just goes down on a subconscious level and feeds the information to the mind. And now we're also realizing to the water in that area, like Emoto and his messages.
Yes.
That now we're sending that divine energy into that crop circle, into that area. And then when everybody looks at the image, they get that message. But, you know, let's look at in 2009, in the summer, we had a freak summer. This was 6 months. I'm just going to give you the punchline so that you'll understand and appreciate it. 6 months before the BP oil spill, we had a freak summer in England where there were 6 or 7 bird formations, a phoenix, a thunderbird, a group of swallows, an owl, different birds. And then we had 6 or 7 fish formations, dolphins chasing each other, trout, the octopus, the squid. We had really bizarre octopus, huge crop circle, but we're all going, dragonfly, what is this? What are they telling us? Because normally we get sacred geometry, but this year we're getting pictograms, pictures of birds, fish, dragonfly, and the ammonite, the ancient spiral. And bang. BP oil spill happened. I think that there was a connection there where they were saying, please notice, please notice. You know, and I also have a feeling that they're also saying about the wheat, the barley, and the corn, please notice, please notice what the farmers are doing to your food. I think it's another big piece of crop circle mystery. Is there's no mystery. Look at the farm fields. This is your food. Something is happening. And one of the only times I interviewed almost a farmer was because of peer pressure. People said to me, well, you've got to interview the debunkers. And I was like, heck no, I'm not interested in that at all. I wouldn't waste clips. And then they said, well, you got to interview a farmer. And I was like, you know, okay, I'll compromise. My heart isn't drawn, but I'll go do it. So I asked around, who's the farmer that mows down more crop circles than anyone else? I figured that'd be interesting, right?
Right.
So I get Mr. Carlson on the phone and he says, sure, I've got 20 minutes. I'll meet you at the barn. So he tells me how to get there. And it was like 40 minutes away. So my friend is with me. She's from Holland and she's wonderful fun. And she said, oh, can I come as your partner? And I said, heck yeah, get in the car. Let's go. So we get to the farm. We're all on time. I'm setting up the camera and Mr. Carlson's standing there in front of his big combine machine. And it's just perfect lighting. Everything was right. I take the tripod out of the trunk and the camera will not go on the tripod. Absolutely would not go on. And I'm like turning it over, twisting it, changing the base. I'm like, I do this all the time. I backward, forward, my camera. I just like rammed it on the side and kind of had to hold it. In into the car, grabbed the mics, set them up. And I was having this health problem. So my hands were in gloves and Band-Aids because my fingertips had cuts. And it was really difficult. But neither microphone would work. So it was 16 batteries to change them. And I thought, oh, I must have left one on. Crap. So he's like, well, mate, I'm down to 12 minutes. You must hurry. And I'm like, I'm going as quick as I can. So I change out all the batteries and I was panting by the time I'm done. Neither mic will work. Camera still won't go on the tripod. So I said to the farmer, as he said, okay, mate, you're down to 7 minutes. I almost have to go now. And I said, tell you what, Mr. Carlson, I don't know if I should say his name, but I said, let's take the camera and just go inside the barn right here. Skip the handsome combine. Skip the nice sunny day because in the camera, I've got a built-in mic. No problem. I got this knee right here. I can get on the ground, use it for a tripod. I'm good to go. Let's go in the barn. He said, no, we can't go in the barn. I said, why not? He said, we just sprayed. I said, what'd you spray? He said, well, we sprayed the wheat too. I said, sir, isn't that food? Isn't this food storage? What'd you spray with that you're not willing to go in there? And he looked right at me and he said, well, ma'am, I guess I'm going to have to go. And he drove away.
Uh-oh.
I looked at my friend and I said, wow, there's one I didn't think about. And this was before all the awareness to me. This was 2008 and I wasn't thinking all these, you know, GMOs and all this. I wasn't really on top of it, but I thought, bang, that was ugly. Wow, I don't think people are allergic to wheat or gluten. What is that farmer spraying? That's really bad.
Thank you.
He drives away, and I said to my friend, you know, I this wasn't my idea. I was doing this because I was peer pressured to do something that wasn't coming naturally to me as a filmmaker who, in my opinion, I feel like I work directly with the circle makers. So I look at her and I said, watch this. I just have a weird feeling. I reach in the trunk, grab the camera and fit right on the tripod and lock down. She's all throwing her arms up in the air like, wow, I can't believe that happened. I said, yeah, watch this. I grabbed the mics and they both worked perfectly.
Oh, my gosh.
I stuck her in front of the combine and I said, tell me what just happened. I'm putting you on film.
And we're going to be diving into the second hour here on a Friday evening. Thanks for tuning in with us. And, of course, our guest is Patty Greer, pattygreer.com, if you want to check out some crop circle photos and just a whole lot of good stuff on there. If you want to give us a call this hour, we'll open the phone lines. It's 347-688-2902. Again, that's 347-688-2902. If you want to join the chat room, that's freedomslips.com. Was it Tuesday, I think? I don't remember what day it was. Tuesday, I think it was. We had about 350 people in the chat room chatting it up and bringing us questions. If you have a question, please go ahead and post it. The producer will be happy to give it to us. I'm sorry I'm not in the party at the chat room, but I'm with you in spirit. Remember that Free Revolution Radio is, listener-supported. As I said before the break, We're going to hear a message from our sponsor. Our sponsors are our listeners. We really appreciate it, and we love the fact that you not only contribute your time and your money, but you've really gotten behind us and shared Revolution. You have brought us up in talk radio to number two. We are number two in talk radio. That is absolutely stunning. I want to thank our owner, Hawk, we call him Nighthawk, for all the work that you put into this, for everything that you've done for all of us. We have over 45 hosts on Revolution Radio. Truth is around the clock, and all of the hosts are volunteers. We're proud family. Thank you, and thanks to our listeners for helping us get through each and every day. If you like the show, go ahead and make a donation and keep me on the air. Again, thank you. So, Patty, you know, we were just talking about this idea that 6 months before the BP oil spill, the formations in 2009 were birds and ocean fish and octopi and ancient spirals, etc., in these wheat, barley, and corn fields. And then you kind of made a connection, which I, you know, when you just told us the story how your camera wouldn't work and your microphones wouldn't work, and all of a sudden, you know, there's no entry to the barn because it's sprayed with obviously some kind of poisonous chemical, which we all ingest. I would think that you thought to yourself that that was meant to be that way that day.
I think that I've had this information shoved in my face like nothing I would have ever imagined. And for me, it's been all firsthand experiences, and I've had enough of them that that's what I have put on film, because I just had my jaw hanging open. You know, for me, it was just like, oh God, my kids have got to see this. My friends back home, I mean, they're not going to come over. I'm going to bring it to them. That's really why I did it. I hired a film crew, and I couldn't even imagine what I was doing, but it was after I'd had an out-of-body experience in 2007. I just started taking an insane amount of photos. I took 1,100 photos in 3 weeks of crop circles.
That's a lot of photos.
And then I hired the film crew at the Glastonbury Crop Circle Symposium because they were the coolest guys. There was three of them. They had all the gear, and they gave me a decent price. And I was like, heck yeah, let's go. So we had a most astounding day. And these are three guys that live in the area, very cool guys that had never, any of them, stepped into a crop circle. You know, it's like not a part of their life.
Gosh. Yeah, so what did they think about the experience?
Well, you know, I'm the kind of boss that I would think people would want to work for, because I said to them, okay, we're done here, you know, 2 hours in a crop circle interviewing four different people. And I said, 10 minutes on your back. I'll talk to you soon.
Interesting. Patty, we've got a caller on the line holding. Can we bring them through?
Sure.
Sure. Caller, you're calling from an unknown phone number, so I cannot identify you. So why don't you identify yourself? Welcome to the Truth Denied Talk Radio. And our guest tonight is Patty Greer. Caller? Caller, you don't want to talk because I can hear you and I can hear you breathing. Well, maybe you're a crop maker, crop circle maker. Anyway, sorry, I don't know why the caller isn't saying anything. So if the producer could drop the call, that'd be great. Thank you for calling. Anyway, by the way, we do have a toll-free number now, 855-655-8453, extension 802. So that's 855-655-8453. Extension 802, and it spells Roxy Lopez loves you. I'm kidding. So if you want to call in on the toll-free number, go ahead. So Patty,
let's take this precious time to talk about the real circle makers, because
that's exactly where I was going to go.
I think it's the most important piece, aside from the fact of how important it is as the first physical manifestation of ET communication. I mean, they're here for everyone. They're in so many different countries. You know, for example, last summer, there were 69 in England alone. Did you know that?
No.
Isn't that stunning?
Yes.
69 in England alone. And there were 56 more documented. And this is just, you know, in one website. But they were found last year, not only in England, many, many of them, but also in Brazil, Argentina, Mexico, America, Australia, Sweden, Germany, Italy, Macedonia, Latvia, Czech Republic, Holland, Belgium. Of course, they get them every year, as does Italy, France, and Germany. But these other countries are documenting them. They're coming in. These calls are coming in from all over the world that people are admitting that they're here. And here I am, the crappie girl. I didn't even know how many we had in America. And when somebody asked me, I just pulled up the research. I was like, oh my God, between 2000 and 2005, we had more than 20 a year documented in America. I didn't know.
Yeah, well, it's not. I didn't either. And you, and isn't that interesting? Because you're now researching and filming these, and I'm in the same boat for many, many, many years, and I didn't even know about them when I was living in Washington. Though, 1994, I wasn't there 2 months, and there was south of Seattle, about an hour south of Seattle, there was a crop circle, and it came to me word of mouth. How about that? And I wanted to go see it. I wanted to go see it. But they actually made it off limits to the public completely. No public was allowed to go anywhere near this thing. And I just thought, well, why not? And then, of course, that was 94. But I think that also happens. You know, it gets quieted, covered up. You don't really see it in any newspapers. I don't even know why they've even bothered to put some of them in newspapers or, you know, in mainstream media, and some of them, you know, you never hear about. Have you ever been to one in the United States?
I have not.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Me neither.
But I did go to England in 2006, 7, 8, skipping 2009. Thank you, helicopters. Mm-hmm. And then I went back in 2010 and 2011. And here's my two favorite stories called How to Lose a Guy by E.T. In 2001, these are the two times, actually, to be respectful to myself, these are the two times I know of where I was taken. And I didn't know at the time, but I certainly know now. And in 2001, I was making a CD. I was playing music. I had a harp, two harps, grand piano, electric piano that I toured with. And I was in the studio. It was all I did. I played music. And I was dating the man that owned the studio. So we were having a really great musical chapter making this CD. And I was living in the mountains west of Boulder, Colorado. And my house was in my backyard. I had a pond that had a little waterfall. So the animals, the wildlife that were in the mountains nearby, could hear water running in my backyard, which was a total magnet. And then I'd sit out there with chopped up apples and oranges, whatever was like, the grocery store was, you know, bruised or whatever. I'd say, I'll take that. Thank you. And I'd cut them up and sit out there and hand feed all these animals. So I had this crazy, wonderful elemental house that just had all this wildlife in the yard all the time. And so I had this boyfriend up at the house, and he was kind of surprised to see how many deer I could feed at one time and that I wasn't nervous about it. And I go to sleep. And when I got up one morning, he was staring at me, and it wasn't a normal stare. Mm-hmm. And he realizes I'm awake, and he just sat up and he goes, "Do you remember what you said in your sleep last night?" And I was like, "Whoa, chill, baby. I just woke up." And he said, "You woke me up by saying, 'It's not what you see, it's what you don't see.'" I was like, "Well, God, cool lyrics." And he grabbed my wrist and he goes, "That's not all. Then you said, 'It's not who you know, it's who you really are.'" And I couldn't get back to sleep. And I was like, wow, cool dream. I want to write those lyrics down. And he grabbed my wrist even harder. And he said, "Oh, that's not all." And I was like, "Honey, I just got up. You're creeping me out. Would you let go of my wrist?" And he was really in a weird kind of state of shock. He said, "I looked out the window where there's usually wildlife, and there was a car going by with two headlights. It made a U-turn and came toward the house. And I realized there was no road back there. It was a mountain." with a waterfall. And so he said the first ball of light came through the bedroom wall and circled the ceiling. I'm like, whoa, heavy dream. There goes the wrist again. He's like, it wasn't a dream. I had never heard this at the time. In 2001, I had no idea what he was talking about. Yes, I did rituals since I was seven with a Ouija board and a candle and the little glass of water with my best friend. But I didn't do, this was not a thought that I had. And so he said, the first ball of light circled the bedroom and I shook the bed so hard yelling at you, but you wouldn't wake up.
Oh, wow.
He said, then the second ball, and it went out the lower living room window, he said, and I watched it leave, and you wouldn't wake up. He said, the second ball of light came through the wall, and it turned bright green like a glow stick when it got on in the inside of the wall and circled. He said, I was so freaked out. The wall, the headboard was hitting the wall. I was shaking the bed so hard, trying to get you to wake up, and you wouldn't wake up. And I'm just like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Please don't get mad at me. I have no idea what you're talking about. I just woke up. So he's had this huge experience. And the green ball of light circled the ceiling. He's shaking the bed, yelling like in a panic. I'm the girl with hand feeding the deer with the big rack of antlers outside every day. So he's thinking that, you know, whack jobs got these balls of light for pets also. I'm, you know, the poor guy was panicked. You know, what am I? I'm just like, I had no idea what he was talking about. So he gets up and I didn't make breakfast for him. He just left and I never had a date with that guy again. So years later, I was in the crop circle in 2007 and I passed out and I think that I had the same experience with the same beings because years later in 2010, they were showing my movie 2012 or already in it at the Glastonbury Symposium where everything began for me. It was where all the crop circle speakers were in Glastonbury my first year. And then I used their film crew, paid them, you know. And so all of a sudden now my film is showing there, which was really exciting. It was a nice transition to be welcomed into the community like that. So after the movie showed, Mary Rodwell, who did a lot of regressions, she's an Australian lady, said, let's go to tea. So we were having tea. And I told her about this incident with my boyfriend in 2006 or 2001, but I told her in 2010. So she said to me, you've been jealous all these years that he had the experience and you didn't. Honey, the reason he couldn't wake you up was you were taken. You weren't there. It never crossed my mind. All this time I was like, why did he get the experience and I didn't I? But, you know, it made total sense. He was shaking me ridiculously and yelling in my face. It must be true. So when I realized what happened in the crop circle felt extremely similar, I had an interesting confirmation, which was that Mary Rodwell took me on a 3-hour regression journey, and my boyfriend at the time set up the camera and filmed my regression and changed the role a couple times because it was a 3-hour regression. But when I listened to it the one time, I remembered everything like it was brand new. And where they took me both times, which was interesting, was this beautiful crystal castle. It was underwater, and I saw myself going there. And I wouldn't normally talk about this because, you know, yeah, so what, you had a dream or a therapist thing, but it ties together to a pretty interesting kind of proof of this from the circle makers. So I see this crystal castle, and I'm talking about it on film in 2010, and I see it clear as day that it's really gorgeous colors, like I forgot about since early Disney, but they were more pastel, like ultraviolet, ultra pink, ultra blue, like those colors that make your heart jump out. You forgot because our world is so black and white and beige and tan and gray, right?
Gosh.
I mean, what's hip? Black, white, gray, tan. Mm-hmm. That's what's hip. But so these colors, and I'm seeing them in this wherever they took me, really colorful. And then there's these pyramids, and they're the colors also. And then all of a sudden we stop, and there we are at this crystal castle. It's five cylinders and a crystal star at the top, and it's all water around it. And I'm seeing this thing just like, wow. So this last summer, 2012, I had a friend come up to the house, and she said, oh, I want to show you this artist's work. And it was in the middle of end of summer, like I think it was July 29th or June 29th. I can't remember which. But she said, I want to show you this artist, unbelievable, beautiful work. And this is, you know, a couple of years after my regression and years after those experiences. And so she opens up her computer and she shows me this beautiful artwork by Ariel Ali, E-R-I-A-L, Ali, A-L-I.us. Unbelievable, people. You need to look at this guy's work. But the thing opens up and it start like tears going down my face. I can hardly breathe. She's like, what's going on? Are you okay? And I said, I've been here. Where is this place? I've totally been here. Where is this place? And it was the Crystal Castle. So this artist somehow had painted this place where they took me. And it was really beautiful and the ultraviolet, ultra pink, ultra blue. It was the place. So I said, I don't know what this is or who it is, but tomorrow I'm going to call this artist and see where this place is because I've been here. And I don't remember when or what, but I've, you know, so I'm going through this whole emotion, and it's 10:30 at night in Colorado, Mountain Standard Time, which is 5 in the morning in England. So I am connected to a couple of these websites where in the morning when they have a crop circle, they send me an email with photos of the crop circle that happened while I slept. So I get up in the morning and I get my email from the cropcircleconnector.com, great website to join. They'll send you an email whenever there's a new crop circle, which is almost every day in England. And so I get my cropcircleconnector.com email and I open it up. Roxy, swear to God, it was the Crystal Castle.
Oh my gosh.
I'm like hyperventilating. My friend comes downstairs for coffee and I just point. I didn't say a word. I said this, well, I said this crop circle happened last night, 10 at night, 5 in the morning in England. I believe, and again, this is just my interpretation, but while I was having this experience of going, oh my God, I acknowledge that I remember where they took me. It was a crystal castle. Bang. I felt like they just left me a sticky note in England. So that it would be like a confirmation to remind me, no matter what I'm dealing with on earth, with humans, distributors, difficulty, you know, with these great movies, but difficult with humans, that they're just going, we're here. We really appreciate, we acknowledge you. I mean, it was like, it felt like such a direct link to me with them. And I thought, you know, I must be imagining this, but my friend is looking at it going, whoa. And not only is there a crystal castle, but there's five drips below it of water.
It's wow.
Like, I'm just, you know, in heaven. So I start to study this formation and I said to my friend, you know, what's interesting is there's not any circle in this formation. And most of the crop circles, there's at least a circle somewhere. This one has no circle. So I went to the other website, which I'll tell your listeners. It's called silentcircle.uk. And it's a great website to archive all the crop circles that happen every year. The Crop Circle Connector has older archives, and both of them I highly recommend. But the silentcircle.uk website, you can spin and span all the photos in a row rather than having to go to each one separately. So I went to that one because there were 69 last summer, but this is like the end of July. So there might've been only 55 or 60, 65, whatever. There were a lot. And I thought, you know, this is weird. There's no circle. I wonder if there were others. So I spanned through all of them and there weren't. It was the only one. It was an exception. It was the Crystal Castle with five water drips below. And I was just really moved by it. So I just, you know, made a comment about it and went about my time. And then the next day when I woke up, there was phase two of that crop circle. And sometimes the circle makers give them to us in phases. But the next day, that crop circle had three times the size of the crystal castle, this huge circle with a goddess inside it.
Oh, my gosh.
I'm just like spouting like a whale, just like, you know, I can't even talk. I'm just like, you know, nobody's going to believe this. This is just for me. This is good enough. This is, wow, I love you guys. I mean, this is why I stay so devoted with making their movies. They just keep giving me really beautiful direct messages where I just can't deny it.
So, now, that's very interesting. You know, I was going to ask you, Patty, you know, first of all, you know, you mentioned Ariel, the artist. Could yes. we get that website again from you?
Ariel.us. Ariel.us. And his name is Ariel Ali, A-L-I. So I called him the next day and he answered. I felt so lucky. And he's just a humble, wonderful guy. But I mean, he puts out like a new painting a week. He's doing unbelievable work and it's all fifth dimensional art. And I said to him, this happened last night. Oh my God, I got a crop circle. I have to send it to you. Who are you? What is this picture? And he said, it's the Library of Illumination, the Akashic Records Library.
Wow.
So four movies happened in 2 years with no training. And I think it's because of my visit there that really I understand now. Back then I was like, I had no idea. And I feel like the information that has come through these films is really direct from them. And in 2010 was the most shocking one of all. It was when I guess this goes in my chapter called How to Lose a Boyfriend by E.T. This is the other one. I'm madly in love. I mean, God, it was great. And he came to the crop circles with me 2 different years, and he came to the International UFO Congress with me, which is a complete crash course in ufology. I mean, you just eat it, drink it, sleep it, and then you get up and do it again for 10 hours. Have you been to one yet?
I don't believe so.
I love the event. It's so many speakers.
I've been to so many, but I don't know if I've been to that.
Right. Well, that one is 800 of us in one resort for 7 days.
Fun.
That's a lot of ET energy in one
resort. Oh, yeah, it is. Absolutely. So you had this boyfriend.
So I had this boyfriend.
For a couple of years who went to all of this with you. And what happened?
Well, I won 3 Ebby Awards for best film at this event. I mean, I really was in the community, really connecting, and they love the work. So I went back to England and I had made 4 movies. And I said to my boyfriend, I want to leave the camera home. I just want to play in the crop circles and go, you know, have a trip in a little bit of Europe with you. And he goes, no, let's bring it. I'll carry it on my back. And I said, no, you don't understand. If we have a camera, they will make me make a movie. And he said, no, that's silly. I'll carry it. You know, it'll be really easy. And I said, you don't understand. I really want to leave it. I don't want to make another movie. I mean, it was an interesting banter that nobody could understand, but he ended up bringing the camera. So we go one morning to the most amazing crop circle with every center was absolutely like an artwork. And we got up at 6:30 to get into the formation before other people would come. So we'd been in there an hour and a half and done all this beautiful filming, you know, just for us, no movie. And we go to the silent circle, which is the research center down there in Wiltshire, where all the researchers kind of come in. It's our little magnet spot, and we hook up with everybody and whisper if there's a new crop circle and go running off together to see it. And you know, you meet all your friends there. It's really fun. And they sell books and different people's work. So at the silent circle, we're sitting there having coffee, and we watch these two guys get out of their car by falling, and they come stumbling toward the center. And I thought they were not well, and I jumped up and I said, "Are you okay?" And he looked into my face with the dizziest eyes and said, "Oh, what we saw last night." I said, "Honey, get him coffee, please."
Right.
Yes, actually, I'm going to be speaking at two seminars. One is the Roswell Museum, and it's a big event. They supposedly draw 100,000 UFO researchers in the course of 3 or 4 or 5 days. I haven't been, but in my contract, it said that I have to have the ability to wave and smile for an hour on their float in the parade of lights. So I guess it's a big event in Roswell once a year, and it's right after the 4th of July. We'll be there the 5th, 6th, 7th, and I'll be speaking and showing one or two movies. Whenever I go anywhere to speak, I always want to show as many as possible because that's why they give it to me. And that's why they put us on your show, is to get the word out to people.
Great.
And the other one is for Dolores Cannon at her transformational event, and that's at the end of July.
Perfect. That's the 19th to the 21st, right?
I believe so, and that's in Arkansas.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. And let's see, can people meet you at the Roswell conference?
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to have a booth there all the days, and I'm going with a really fun friend, and we're going to, you know, I love these events because I like being surrounded by intelligent people, people that we can talk to. And, you know, at a time like this, when the wheat and the chaff are separating so dramatically, there's not a lot of people we can talk to. And then when we find our kind, it's just, we kind of latch on like, you know, Klingons, like, oh, thank God I have somebody I can talk to, when you've been out in the desert for a few days with, say, family reunion or something.
Oh, yeah. I bet you there are a lot of people who can absolutely relate to that. And isn't it fun when you do get to together with those who are like-minded? It's not a big deal either, though. You know what I mean? Like, all the conversation is just normal. You don't have to watch what you're saying and when you're saying it. Everything's just completely normal. It's almost like a bubble of an alternative reality or something. But back to these two guys. So you're going to make them some coffee because they're dazed and confused, literally, and they just saw a happening. What was it?
Well, we were actually at the silent circle. I wasn't making them coffee. I was helping them not fall on their faces, but we sat them down in the chairs and we brought them some coffee from the cafe, and they just stared at the ground. And the guy just said, "My eyes don't lie. I know what I saw." And I said, "What did you see?" And he said, "These balls of light were big and bright and orange. And all of a sudden, there were these illuminated light beings with arms, legs, and a head. One of them came out this doorway in the ball of light." He said it turned around, reached in, and pulled the other one out. I'm like, come on, really? I mean, it's first thing in the morning. And I've got a sense of humor with everything, but this isn't funny. These guys are red-faced like I was, that sunburned thing. And they were staring. They were in shock. It had just happened a few hours earlier. And so the other guy doesn't speak extremely good English. They were from Belgium. But Igor is speaking well for the two of them. And he said they showed up and they disappeared. And then they showed up and then they disappeared. And then these illuminated light beings were there. And he was really, they were both really stunned. And the other guy's nodding. Yeah, yeah, we saw them. So I said, "Did anybody else see them?" And he said, "Well, you know, we had given up for the night. And then we had gone up the hill and we met these French people who had just seen balls of light. And so we got our coats on and went out, and it took about 5 minutes. And then they saw them plus the illuminated light beings, which is just huge." So I looked at the guy and I looked at my boyfriend and I said, "You know, I'm really trying not to make a movie, but can I interview you? I mean, would you mind telling me again what just happened, but over there behind the church?" So it's like, I couldn't have set up a better stage. There's steps and they're all old rock and the lighting is perfect and the wind is low. So these guys give the interview and it's really, really incredible that they had just had this experience. So we go back to the silent circle and we're having another cup of coffee with them, and they're explaining this amazing experience. And he points with a weak finger and he goes, oh, there's the French people. So I jumped up and said, did you really see that? And they said, yeah, yeah, we don't know what it was, but we saw them. So I looked at my boyfriend. I said, I'm really trying not to make a movie, but I think we need to interview them. So we go and set them up behind the church, and they were amazing. They didn't see the illuminated light beings, but they definitely saw the orange balls of light, and they described them in the same way. And it was pretty shocking. So that night we were kind of quiet about it, but the guy that owns the Silent Circle that's been there 15 years and has heard every story said to my face, grabbing my arm, that's probably the best story I've ever heard. If you really got that on film, hang on to it. So I was like, oh, great, you know. So now it's important, too. Of course it is. What a crazy story. So I'm kind of, you know, thinking, what am I going to do with this? I really don't want to spend another 30 grand for an editor and do this again. But, wow, this is amazing. So the next day, we go a couple hours away to Glastonbury, England, to a wedding. But on the way, we stopped at this crop circle called the Roundaway Farm. They named them after the farm, the farmer's family, so or the land, whatever. But it was the Roundaway Formation. And we, most of the crop circles, it's really funny, the researchers were kind of this stubborn group because there's so many right there in Wiltshire that if there's a crop circle an hour and a half away, that's too far to drive. Are you kidding me? You know, but I was one of the people that would do the drive or pay the pilot to fly me further when, you know, the other ones are like, if it's raining, they're not even going in the formations because they live there in England. A lot of them were in Holland, just a hop, skip and a jump. So I go in all of them, even if I'm muddy to death. But we go up to this formation and I hear these children laughing. And I thought, well, you know, that might be interesting to interview these kids to see what they think. So I asked the mom if I could interview the kids. And she said, yeah, we speak Dutch and they don't speak English, but I will translate for you. So she sits the kids down and one of the little boys has a problem walking. So he's got the big dog that helps. And so the little girl starts talking. She's maybe five with long blonde ringlets and big blue eyes and the funny teeth. And she just fires up because the mom asked them, what do you think of this crop circle? This lady wants to know. So the little girl's going, talk, 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 talk in Dutch. And finally, the mother looks into the camera and says, my poor boyfriend, she doesn't want to talk about this crop circle. She wants to talk about the one we were in the other day in his field where she saw the orange balls of light. And they told her the crop circle wasn't done yet. I'm like, I leaned into the camera and I said, it's July 29, 2010. This child just said the crop circle's not done yet in East Field. And it was made by Orange Balls of Light documenting. And just in case it got bigger the next day, you know, and a five-year-old, like, who's going to make that up? I don't know. So it's pretty amazing. And the child goes on to say, yeah, it was bright orange, like a flame around a candle. And she's going on. It was really impressive to see the passion of this child. So then we go to the wedding that night, and at the end of the table where we were at the restaurant after the wedding, we meet Eddie from Holland, and I said, what do you do? He said, I do automatic writing where I close my eyes and spirit takes my arm and writes through me. I said, have you written anything interesting lately? And he says, yeah, yeah. And he pulls out his book from his back pocket, slaps it on the table. Roxy swear, it said, orange, yes. And off to the left was a sketch of the crop circle with added elements. And this guy from Holland said, yeah, the other day I was in a crop circle in East Field. And at this point, my boyfriend steps on my foot, just about wrecks a toe. And that look where somebody's like cross-eyed with their mouth going, what the, He just was like, are you kidding me? And I looked at him and I said, remember the camera? I told you, if I bring the camera, this happens. And it just really freaked him out because it really does happen. And so this guy says, yeah, they told me that the crop circle wasn't done yet. So I said, I'm not going to tell you why, but I need to interview you after this wedding. Do you mind if we follow you to your B&B? So he let us, and we filmed him. And I come home with these four stories. And I didn't even see, I mean, this poor guy that went with me, it was too much. I mean, the ETs, in my opinion, are working very closely with many of us. And they're very blatant. And they're not doing anything harming anyone. I think it's really all about ascension. I think it's all about upgrading people in large quantities now. And some of us that are their transmitters, like you, like me, they choose us and then they get us work in their program, which is to help people wake up. It's a really good incentive program, in my opinion. I'm happy to do the work. I'd like to be done with this Mercury crock.
Right. Well, and I think what happened to your now ex is, you know, you get your mind blown. And like you said, it's just, for some people, it's just too much. It's just, you know, it's connecting the dots right in front of you. It's very blatant, as you said, and it freaks people out.
Yeah.
Well, and they want to go back. You know what I mean? They want to take a step backwards, back into where everything was, you know, quote unquote, normal again.
Yeah. And I'm in such deep surrender to all of it because, you know, when you have an experience, have you had an experience where you've seen a craft?
I've had many experiences.
Awesome. Sorry. And I should know who you are, what you do. So
no, don't worry about it. Go ahead.
The point is that after you've had many experiences, let alone just one, it's not like you're a believer anymore. Now you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not like we're arrogant. It's just, please stop yelling that it's fake. And I don't want to hear it because it's just kind of a waste of my energy. I know it's true for me. Doesn't mean it's true for you. And until you have your experience, and I don't mean to say arrogant, but I think that they're here. So many people are having experiences. It's just a matter of time for everybody else. But if they were here to hurt us and harm us, we'd be done. Who's here to harm us and hurt us are the ones doing the chemtrails and the GMOs in the food and the fluoride in the water. What on earth are they thinking? Which leads me to my newest project, which I finished today, which is why I keep clearing my throat. I was singing a lot. I recorded a song that I just wrote called We Want Our Planet Back. And the subtitle is A Message from the Animals, Plants, and Children of Earth. And when you listen to it, it's three-part harmony. It sounds like a really great grown-up song. But then all of a sudden, the chorus goes, no more GMOs hiding in our food. So it's like, wait a minute, isn't she just singing a pretty song with all these backups? And now we're talking about GMOs and fluoride. It's like, you know what, Roxy, however we can get it out.
Right.
The better.
And I want everybody to know that, and by the way, beautiful. Are you playing any of the instruments? The piano sounds wonderful in that song.
Thank you. Yes, I play piano.
Oh, it's fabulous.
Thank
and
you.
And you have a wonderful voice, too. What I was going to say is we're going to put the song into the video of the show. So I want everybody to know that when you go and listen to the show in the archives on the YouTube channel, we're going to add, with your permission, of course, We Want Our Planet Back to that so that everybody can hear it.
Thank you.
You're
well,
welcome.
The music video is the 2 years that I was in Telluride with this partner. Every single day when he finished work building these mega million-dollar homes, we would hop in his open Jeep and go out into the 11, 12,000 foot altitude peaks on Jeep roads to the end of everything we could find. And here I've got this big, beautiful movie cameras strapped in the back seat. No roof, no doors, but we had everything, tarps and stuff if it rained. And he was fearless where he would drive. So I would see the strangest things in nature and I would just say, oh my God, stop the car. And I would get out and film things. So I've come back with miles of footage of really incredible deep nature. And this song, We Want Our Planet Back, that's a message from the wildlife, is starring all these different wildlife animals. And absolutely beautiful nature. It's kind of like Ariel Ollie's
yes.
image was, where your heart just goes, oh my God, I almost forgot that Earth is that beautiful, or that mm-hmm. a place can be that beautiful.
I love it. I love it. It's such a great reminder. And, you know, thank you, Patty. I mean, thank you so much for the work that you're doing and your amazing. You're an extraordinary woman, courageous woman, taking it on. And I think that you're going to go very, very far. I love the idea that you have so many of the videos. I mean, you've got a complete package. People can buy like all the DVDs and CDs and soundtracks and the whole nine yards all at once, right?
Well, yes, thank you. I would love it if people would, because this is how we move forward and make new movies.
Yes.
And, but you know, I call it I've got a new piece of art that I just posted up, and I'm just calling the movie collection A Crash Course in Crop Circles and the Real Circle Makers. So I want to finish this story about the Four Stories, One Event, Other Worlds movie. I meet these four different groups of people. They all saw the balls of light. They all saw the balls of light over the Eastfield crop circle, and the little child and the guy from Holland with the auto riding with his eyes closed both said the circle wasn't done yet. The next day it was bigger, phase two. And 3 days later, August 3rd, it was bigger again. And just my movie trailer, which I show for free on the website on pattygreer.com. If you look at the movie trailer for Four Stories, One Event, Other Worlds, you'll see all those people that you'll meet them. And then you'll see the three phases of that crop circle. I mean, to me, this is a powerful and important story because, again, like you, Roxy, you've had experiences. Like so many people, it's not a matter of believing or wanting to know. The people that have had experiences, we don't have any doubt anymore that it is happening and that many of these things are indeed real.
I agree with you. You know, in your best guesstimate, who are the circle makers, Patty?
Well, I think these illuminated light beings coming out of the balls of light is one of the most important stories for me so far. And the interesting thing about this was that I took those four stories home to America, and Charles, who owns the Silent Circle, kept saying to me, oh, you've got to talk to this woman. She saw the illuminated light beings also that night from across the field. She was on top of Silbury Hill. I was just like, you're kidding. So he said, no, I got to hook you guys up because her story is as amazing as these guys from Belgium. So he calls her and she says, sure. So he gives me her contact, email, Skype, and phone. And she wouldn't answer anything. She would not talk to me while I was making the movie. Never got a word back. So finally, I finished the film. I had to give up on her. I didn't know her story. And as soon as I finished it and sent it off to print, she Skypes me. I said, well, God, what took you so long? I just finished the movie. She said, I couldn't talk to you while you were making the film because I have three children to protect. I said, what does that mean? She said, I couldn't talk about it, but I'm happy to tell you now. I said, please. She said, we were across the hill. We were on Silbury Hill. I had these two guys, my man and another man on my left. And behind us were these teenagers that were kind of yakky and drinking. And all of a sudden, we saw the mist come across the field. And we got quiet because it was an odd mist. And out of it, she said, dropped these two orange balls of light. And one of them turned around and a doorway opened up. And I was like, holy crap, that's what Igor told me. And I'm like, whoa, really? And she said, the next thing we knew, we turned around and the teenagers were out cold under what looked like a big black tarp. Like it looked like something had draped a big black plastic blanket over them and they were out, which is really an interesting thing that it wasn't for them. So the three of them are standing there. The guy, she said, I could hear their knees banging. They were so scared. And I just kept saying, stay calm. She said, Patty, the next thing we knew, the whole base of Silbury Hill, which is this seven-year-old ancient mound where people have been coming to do ritual for thousands of years, she said the whole base was these white illuminated light beings with arms, legs, and a head. And they were walking around the base of Silbury Hill. I'm just like, come on, seriously, you saw this? She said, yeah, we did, all three of us. And it was really amazing because all of a sudden they raised their arms up and started spinning around like those Russian dancers and disappeared.
Wow.
It was really incredible. So I was like totally moved. And I said, can I send you the photos I have of the orange balls with these doorways? And she said, you have photos? And I said, let me send it to you by email while we're on Skype. So I sent her the photos and she got really quiet. And then she just started trance speaking by saying, I can't believe they let you take these photos. I can't believe they let you take their photos. And she just kept repeating it. So that was really cool. So I finished the film and all of my witnesses from Holland, Belgium, and France, none of them had taken photos. But years before, my friend Monique and I, the one that with the farmer thing that had sprayed.
Yes.
I called her and I said, did you remember those pictures we took of the orange balls of light that night? She said, yeah. I said, start sending them, please. I need all of them. So she sends them and son of a gun, between hers and mine, you can see the ball of light. And then all of a sudden it looks like somebody took a cut out of the pie and then it turns more and it's a friggin' doorway. And I have like all these different images of these balls of light like I've never seen, and these doorways where these illuminated light beings came out. So I sent them to all my witnesses that none of them had taken photos in Belgium, France, and Holland. And all of them, when I woke up the next morning, said, yeah, those are the ones we saw. Where did you get those photos? Were you there that night? So I knew it was all correct. This movie is so darn correct. So I sent the movies out to all these people when they were done. And Igor calls me from Belgium and he says, oh, the first time I saw the movie, all I could do was laugh because I was staring at the ground and moving my hands so much. But then when I saw it the second time, I remembered the dream. I said, what dream? He said, right after you woke me up at the camper van, I remembered the dream. And I said, I didn't wake you up at your camper. I met you at the silent circle where you fell out of your car. No, you woke me up at the camper van. I said, no. That wasn't me. Did you give anybody else an interview? He said, no, you were the only one. I said, tell me about the dream. He said, they showed me how they get in and out from the worlds. I said, tell me. He said, now they didn't talk to each other. He didn't know this girl. He said to me, they put their arms up in the air and they start spinning and they disappear.
Unreal.
So
unreal.
I really feel like we've got some really advanced crop circles.
What's the name of the movie? We've got about 20 seconds left, Patty. What's the name of the movie?
One Event, Other Worlds. And the practice movie you got to watch before that or it's too shocking is called Crop Circle Update, The Wake-Up Call. And both of them are on pattygreer.com.
Who's in charge? charge here?
Who's in charge here?
Let's do it differently. It's sickening all the people, and it's killing all the trees. It's falling in our eyes, and it's getting harder to see the beauty that is our world and the freedom to be free. It's landing in the water, we know it's in the air. It's time for you and me to show we care. Say no to GMOs hiding in our food, and no to fluoride in our water too.
Who's in charge here?
Let's save this family and do what's right for Earth and you and me. Step into the new way,
into the new way,
where we live in harmony. No more war, no more fracking, we are free.
Who's in charge?
Let's do it differently. Sickening all the people, and it's killing all the trees. It's falling in our eyes, and it's getting harder to see the beauty that is our world and the
freedom
to be free.
Free energy.
Oh, look at who